Chapter 34 Supermax. The debriefings were over, the psychiatrist had his final meeting, and in July 2002, Robert Hansen was transferred to the Supermax, the toughest prison in the federal system, where he began serving his life sentence. He was now a number, 485-5108. His new world had shrunk to a 7.5 by 12 foot cell with thick bars and a steel door in the high security wing. A concrete slab with a thin mattress served as his bed. The tiny 4-inch window allowed only a view of the sky and the roof. The Supermax, technically the Administrative Maximum Facility, or ADX, in Florence, Colorado, housed the most violent and dangerous criminals in America. Terrorists, serial murderers, mafia hitmen, gang leaders, and drug cartel bosses. The prison also held a handful of spies. Among the notorious inmates sent there were Ted Kaczynski, the Unabomber, Ramzi Youssef, the mastermind of the 1993 World Trade Center bombing, who was later convicted of a plot to blow up a dozen jetliners, Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab, the underwear bomber, and Timothy McVeigh, the Oklahoma City bomber, who was housed there before he was executed. No one had ever escaped from the Supermax. All inmates in the high security unit are held in solitary confinement. They live alone in single-person cells, staggered so the inmates in many cases cannot have eye contact with each other. A warden of the Supermax called the prison a clean version of hell. Hansen was first imprisoned in the Supermax for 23 hours a day. He was allowed an hour a day to exercise. Since then, some of the prison's rules have changed, and Hansen was able to get out of his cell 4 hours on weekdays and 2 hours a day on weekends. He could use that time to exercise, read, shower, or a combination of those. Like its prisoners, the ADX is isolated, located 110 miles due south of Denver in the barren foothills of the Rockies. It was opened in 1994 and can house up to 490 inmates. 1,400 electronically controlled gates clang shut to seal off the units. Watchtowers ring the facility, and there are laser beams and sensors to detect any movement in the area between the prison walls and the razor wire ringing the perimeter. When prisoners are allowed out to exercise, Christopher B. Sinsvall, the prisoner's supervising attorney, said, "Inmates are taken out one at a time, in shackles, and escorted by guards to a small wire cage. Some exercise cages are inside the prison walls, others outside. Like other high-security prisoners, Hansen can exercise by himself or in a group." "What it looks like is an outdoor batting cage," Sinsvall said. "He is escorted by officers, placed in the pen, and restraints removed. In the cage," he said, "prisoners can run, do push-ups and sit-ups. Hansen cannot walk or run very far. The cage is small, although about double the size of his cell." Inmates eat in their cells. Meals are brought to them and handed to them through a food slot. Todd Chapman, a public information officer at the prison, said that every cell has a television. "We control what channels they see. They can view all the major broadcast networks and cable, but no HBO. That is because the Supermax controls what films prisoners can watch, and no R-rated movies are allowed." If Hansen thought he might be able to use his considerable computer skills at the Supermax, he was greatly disappointed. "At ADX, no inmates have access to computers," Chapman said. "The exception is the law library, which has computers that are only able to search legal statutes, which are online." Should he ever be transferred to a less severe prison, computer access would be up to the warden. Even if granted, he would never be allowed online. The FBI does not want Robert Hansen ever again to be able to communicate with Moscow. Unlike most prisoners at the Supermax, Hansen, from the start, was placed under a draconian restriction known as Special Administrative Measure, or SAM. The SAM is imposed by the United States Attorney General for 1 year, but may be renewed and extended indefinitely. It was. After 15 years, Hansen was still under a SAM. The SAM meant he was cut off almost completely from the outside world. Under the provisions of the SAM, Hansen could not have contact with anyone other than his wife, members of his immediate family, his priest, and his attorney. I discovered this when I attempted to send a letter to Hansen seeking an interview. In return, I received a stern letter from the then warden, Robert A. Hood, informing me that, at the direction of the Attorney General, the special restrictions on Hansen prohibited him from contact with the news media because there was a substantial risk of disclosure of secrets that would pose a threat to the national security of the United States. Hansen was also prohibited from receiving mail or writing to anyone except his family and his lawyer. Hansen's family had hoped he would be sent to Allenwood, the federal prison in central Pennsylvania, where he could be visited more often, since it is much closer to them. But the Bureau of Prisons decided to send him instead to the grim Supermax. Perhaps the government thought he deserved an extra measure of punishment, or counterintelligence officials worried that even locked down alone in a maximum security prison cell, he might somehow devise a way to slip more secrets to the KGB. Soon after Hansen arrived in the prison in Florence, Colorado, Bonnie Hansen, accompanied by her daughter Susan and Hansen's frail 90-year-old mother Vivian, visited him. No physical contact with Hansen was permitted. They spoke to him by telephone through thick glass. He described to them the harsh conditions in the Supermax. He complained he was developing hip trouble from sleeping on the concrete slab. "This is really hard time," Hansen said. At first, Hansen received visits from a Greek Orthodox priest who provided him with some books by C.S. Lewis. Later, at Bonnie's request, a young Catholic priest was allowed to see Hansen. Most convicts are sent to the Supermax for at least 3 years. In the second year, some are rewarded for good behavior by having a few restrictions removed. They may be allowed out of their cells for group meetings. In the third year, according to Sinsvall, they can walk with escort to the commissary, the prison store, and can go to group meals. But none of that gradual easing of restrictions in the 3-year steps would be possible for Hansen as long as the Attorney General's SAM remained in place. The only work that might be available to Hansen in the Supermax would be a menial prison job. According to Chapman, jobs are unit orderlies, sweeping, mopping, cleaning, scrubbing. To Bonnie Hansen, what her husband did remained a deep mystery. How such a loving husband and father could have done all this. To Bonnie, as she told her family, there was something so utterly strange and tragic about the whole thing. It was beyond her understanding. But one complaint he voiced to his family was an indication of how, after all that had happened, he had not fully grasped the enormity of what he had done and the cold reality of where he was. "I had thought," Hansen said, "that I might be treated better in prison because of my long years of service." That was pure fantasy by Hansen. Apparently, he could not face the fact that for almost 22 of his 25 years in the FBI, he had, intermittently, betrayed the country he had sworn to protect. When Hansen was an FBI counterintelligence agent, he might have viewed a video of the arrest of Dmitry Fedorovich Polyakov, Top Hat, the first and most valuable agent he betrayed to the Russians. The video had made its way to the West and was even aired on CNN. It showed General Polyakov, his arms handcuffed behind his back, as KGB goons rip off his shirt. Fingers appear on each side of his face, forcing him to look at the camera. Dignified, despite all of this, Top Hat stares straight ahead, knowing full well that when the long months of interrogation are over, he will be executed. He never knew the name of his betrayer.